We are going to Mars. We are going to Mars in the sense that in 10 days only, the InSight NASA mission will land on the planet. It will install a number of geophysical instruments, and the goal is to measure the internal property, to visualize what is the internal of the red planet. I'm a seismologist. I always work on the Earth. But in the past 20 years, I've been working to install a seismometer on Mars. And this is what I'm here for today, to explain to you why is it so important, why do we need to land on a planet in order to understand its interior, why do we need to bring a seismometer, why do we even want to be on another planet or to send men on another planet, and I want to take you with me on this trip. Understanding what is the internal structure of the planet has always been one of the key questions that we have in planetology. Is Venus different from the Earth, different from Mars? And in reality, what we usually know, it's mostly only the surface. You will be surprised to know that until now, we have tried 43 times to reach Mars. 43 missions sent by NASA, ESA, Russia, France, Japan, India. Out of 43 missions, that is a try to put an orbiter around the planet or to land on the planet and go around. Now, out of this mission, most of them failed. Some crashed, some didn't even leave the Earth, exploded on launch. Some missed the planet and got lost in space. Some landed and lasted about 1 minute on the surface. So when you put them all together, our history of reaching Mars is not very successful. Nonetheless, some of them have been extremely successful. You have all seen pictures taken by four of the NASA rovers which have been around, driving around the planet. There are today six spacecraft which are orbiting and taking wonderful pictures like the one you're seeing now. What we get back from this is a planet which is very much alive. The surface, we know it very well. Why we know it well? There are no cities, no forests, no oceans. We can take pictures. We see what there is on the surface of the planet. We see dunes that are moving. We see water seeping out of the dunes. We see massive volcanoes, deep valleys, canyons. We see the traces of the old magnetic field that kept the planet protected and the atmosphere there. We see the sediments that were deposited in the old ocean. So we see a very lively planet. What we have not seen so far, of course, are traces of life. And this is what we are continuously looking for. We know the surface very well. We want to know the interior. To know the interior of a planet is fundamental because in this way we understand how it formed, how it is evolving on Mars, why the magnetic field disappeared 4 billion years ago, what happens to the oceans. And in the end, if Mars ever had conditions or has today conditions to sustain life. To know the interior of a planet, you need to measure a few of the properties from the surface. The main properties you're going to measure are the same that you do when you go to a doctor, really. So you measure the temperature, the heat that comes out from inside. You measure how it moves, the precise rotation. And then you want to measure also waves that go through. Seismic waves, which are produced by meteoritic impacts or by quakes on the planet. This is the same that you do in a medical check. Your kid will measure temperature, will measure how it moves. You will use X-rays to see if the broken bone. You will use ultrasound to image an unborn child. Or you will use magnetic resonance if you have to look into your brain. And in all these technologies, what you do is that you send waves. These waves traverse inside. And then they are measured on the other side by instruments. And when they're measured, they tell you the internal structure. On the Earth, we do the same. The one thing that earthquakes do, which is good, is that they send waves across our planet, and that allows us to know how is the core, how is the mantle, the crust, the internal structure, the composition. Because of this, in planetary exploration, installing seismometers has always been a priority. So all the Apollo missions, all of them carried seismometers on the moon. And there are missions planned for the icy moons of Saturn and of Jupiter. But in reality, the key target now is Mars. We want to really understand the interior structure, and we want to bring a seismometer on Mars. Now, Bring a seismometer on Mars is not very easy still. You need, first of all, to leave the planet, our planet. It took us on the 5th of May an Atlas V rocket like the one you're seeing, and that's 280 tons of kerosene and of liquid oxygen that allow you to leave the atmosphere. All of that will be burned in a couple of minutes, and then you're out of the Earth, and you go toward Mars. Reaching Mars is 300 million miles. We cannot do it every day. We have a window of opportunity of 3 weeks every 2 years in which we can actually go. That's when the two planets are at closest. Otherwise, it would be far too distant. And once we do our 300 million kilometers, that lasts about 6 months. Today, 10 days before the landing, what we have is that we are a bit less than 2 million miles left to go, and we are speeding up at 7,000 miles per hour in reaching Mars. We actually do not reach Mars. The way it works is that you position your spacecraft on the orbit of Mars, in front of Mars, and then Mars arrives from the back, very fast. And as you understand, you need to soften your landing, and the way it's done is complicated on Mars, much more than on the Earth, because Mars has only a very thin atmosphere. It's about 2 kilometers of atmosphere, about 1% of the density of the Earth. So we land in very low terrain, otherwise there is no atmosphere at all. And low terrain means like in a deep valley. In order to use all the thickness of the atmosphere possible to slow down by friction, by heat, and in order to then open a big parachute and then use retro rockets for the last 100 meters so that we can land softly. Actually, we cannot steer anything from here. Everything's done automatically because it takes only 6 minutes for the entire landing from when the spacecraft begins to feel Mars. It takes no more than 6 minutes to be on the ground, and it takes more than 10 minutes to actually talk to the spacecraft from here. Mars is far away. And so everything will happen by itself, and by the time we get the first signals, we are already on the ground. By the time we get the first image taken and we start breathing again, we know that this thing works and we'll be on the ground. Now, once we are on the ground, we are back to be seismologists. That means it takes about 3 months to install the sensor with a robotic arm to find the right place to put it in, and then to protect it, to put the cover, to do all the tests, the so-called commissioning, and then we will start sending data back, do the first experiments. After 3 months, everything goes quiet, and the station will work for the next years. Nominally, 2 Martian years, 1 Martian year, 2 Earth years. Now, what do? We send data back to us, and this data will be processed. Here in Zurich, there will be what we call a Mars quake service. It means a service that every day processes the data coming down, detects impacts, detects quakes, and computes magnitude, location, exactly like we do normally for a seismic service on Earth. And once we do that, that will be fed to all of the research teams around the world. You will see it on the website, events where they take place on Mars. Now, of course, on the Earth, to do research in seismology, we have thousands of stations. On Mars, we'll have one. And that means that we have to readapt all the technologies that we use here in order to be able to do them with one station. Practically, what happens is that we go back 100 years. 100 years ago, each seismologist had only one station. They were not exchanging to each other, and each one was doing its own analysis by itself. That's what we will be doing on Mars with one station. But it will be enough, together with the data from heat flow and together with the data from the rotation, to actually detect and understand how the planet is composed, where the temperature, how high it is, how it is distributed, and how it is stratified, if the inner core is fluid, and so on, to a level that so far we have never had. Now, however, the question, it's always a good question, is it worth to go all the way to Mars to do that? Is scientific curiosity really sufficient to explain why go with a big mission to Mars, with an expensive mission? Why do we want to send man at all? And to answer to this question, the answers are really deep down, to go way beyond what we call a scientific curiosity or what we can call as an industrial return or innovation return. There are several possible answers. The first is that we go because we are very emotional. Today, it might be better to send rovers and robots. They cost much less. You can afford to lose a few of them. They work better than humans. It's really better to send robots and rovers, I have to say. But it's not the same. We feel for the astronauts when we see them going around driving a car on the moon, when they use a shovel to dig a hole, when they salute their flag. We feel for that. And so that's what most people will feel close to. They are almost our avatar on another planet, so we like to see them be there. It's very human for us. Robots are not the same thing. We go because it's there. That's what Edmund Hillary said about the Everest. We like a challenge, and it is extremely difficult to go there, and it's an incredible challenge. And to actually land there is one of the largest challenges we can have today on Earth. And so we go because it's there. We also go because we might need an alternative to our own Earth. As some have said, like Elon Musk or Stephen Hawking, we might be looking for survival in case we do too much damage to our own planet. I see survival as very interesting, but I see it the other way around. I do think that if we want to survive on this planet, it is absolutely necessary that we understand very well how our planet works. And in order to do so, it is necessary to understand how all the planets work. Understanding how the other planets work will teach us what we need to do here. If you think about it, we need to understand if the Mars that we see today was our past or will be our future. At the time in which environment and climate are changing so rapidly, we need to understand how far away are we from a planet that has no water or no life. We want to go because understanding where life comes from and if we are alone in the universe has always been a key question for the human race since the beginning. Every religion poses this question. Every old religion has planets as gods in their representation. And today, we have already discovered more than 4,000 planets in stellar systems around the galaxy, not only in our solar system. And there are new missions, new telescopes, which are running and will be launched to discover more and more planets. We will discover millions of them around our galaxy. And many of them will have conditions of habitability in terms of oxygen, water, temperature, distance from the star, which will be very close to the one of the Earth. So the question, it's a very good question in the sense of, do we still want to believe that life is only here? Or do we want to believe that the origin of life, the push to life, is so powerful that whenever it finds the right condition in the universe, life will be there? In 2020, there will be two big rovers going on Mars, one from NASA, one from ESA. They're loaded with instruments to find traces of past or present life. If they find it, the drive to send humans to Mars will be irresistible. And in the end, we want to go because of fear and because of hope. The last 10,000 years of history, the entire history of our human race on this planet, have been extremely interesting, extremely exciting. But what are going to be the next 10,000 or the next 10 million years? And we fear that we have actually arrived, that we have discovered most of everything that needs to be discovered, that from now on the Earth, is only a question of maintaining this planet in order, somehow. And the Earth used to be very large and very mysterious. The mystery is gone, and we miss the mystery. And so we, in the end, we need to hope that actually we have not yet arrived, that there is something that we don't know, that is much bigger than what we've done so far. We need to know that we're not alone, that there is somebody else in the universe. And then, of course, we will need to connect. Thank you.